Hey everyone, welcome into the Fantasy Pros Football Podcast. My name is Kyle Yates and I am your host. I'm joined by Mike Taglier as always, and you can find us on Twitter at KyleYNFL and at Mike Taglier NFL. Tags, how was your weekend, man?
It was pretty good. It was really good. I mean, I actually didn't even realize how good my weekend was until I got in this podcast recording room because I got new headphones. And the little things in life, right, where, you know, I went from headphones that I had for, I think, the last 10 years, and I upgraded. Now I could actually hear you, and basically it's probably going to make me a little more feisty because I just think you're yelling at me all the time.
The volume's amped up. Well, hey, guys, we are joined by Matt Harmon of Yahoo Sports. He's also the creator of one of the greatest tools out there, Reception Perception. He can be found on Twitter at MattHarmon_BYB. Matt, I was looking at your Twitter earlier today, man. You're 500 followers away from 100,000. Congrats, man. That's so close.
Oh, man. Yeah, that is very close. I mean, we all know it. I feel like it picks up this time of year because people are kind of tuning back in to football. Like, oh, right, I haven't thought. The normal well-adjusted people out there have not thought about football, much less fantasy football, for months and months at a time. You know, meanwhile, us sickos, like the three of us, you know, we're going back on this stuff 12 months out of the year, every day of the week. So this is usually when people start to come back in. But yeah, it's pretty cool, man. And I appreciate you guys having me on. I'm looking forward to this today. We were talking a little bit before we got rolling here just about how weird this season feels, like whether, you know, at all different levels, it feels very weird. But still getting together, doing little mock drafts like this, it does bring a sense of normalcy to our lives.
Yep.
That is for sure. And we are the Fantasy Degenerates. That is, I think, someone changed their name in the mock draft lobby that we're about to do. The Fantasy Degenerates here. Well, hey, guys. Today we'll be doing a mock draft, using our mock draft lobby. These mocks are designed to allow you to perform quick drafts against human opponents with smart, realistic bots filling in the gaps. And plus, the interface is the same as our draft simulator, so it's very simple and easy to use. And I got to say this, speaking of the draft simulator, have you ever wanted to draft against Tags, Dan, or myself? Well, now you have the chance. Our draft simulator now gives you the option to draft against the three of us. To activate this feature, just launch the draft simulator and click on Fantasy Pros Experts in the draft against section. Not only can you see how your team stacks up against ours at the end of the draft, but each of us will give your squad a draft grade as well. Come check out both our draft simulator and our mock draft lobby at fantasypros.com/draftwizard. Again, that's fantasypros.com/draftwizard. And then before we get into the mock draft itself, guys, I have to remind everyone about this giveaway that we're doing. Listen to some of the things that we're giving away here, Tags. This is ridiculous.
Yeah.
A signed Davante Adams helmet. That sounds great, right? Mm-hmm. Wait, there's more. A $200 gift card for Pristine Auction. A $200 gift card to Porter Road Butcher. A package of fantasy football goods for your league's champion and last place loser from Trophy Smack, and a 1 month subscription to Fubo TV. We'll be giving away this grand prize package away once we hit 7,000 reviews on Apple Podcasts, and we are at 6,786 reviews right now. In addition, we are going to give a bonus to the winner if they are a subscriber to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/fantasypros. The bonus prize will be a Zoom call with our fantasy analyst. Just head to fantasypros.com/contest and fill out the form there. Just leave an honest review on iTunes or Stitcher for the podcast and use the form to submit your screenshot of your review along with your screenshot of your YouTube subscription to qualify for the bonus prize. Again, head to fantasypros.com/contest to enter. All right, guys, I want to talk about this really quick. Over the weekend, the Las Vegas Raiders signed Theo Riddick. They release former CFL star William Standback, and they pick up Theo Riddick. So I wanted to talk about this before we get into the mock draft, because I think this does carry some weight, or maybe in your opinion, it doesn't, as to the pass catching involvement for Josh Jacobs. So Matt, I'll throw this over to you first. Like, what does this signing mean to you? Are you concerned at all about Josh Jacobs?
I mean, it's so weird because on one hand, you know, you have John Gruden kind of reportedly so upset that Jacobs didn't get Offensive Rookie of the Year last year, that it went to Kyler Murray, that he really wants to, like, get this guy as many touches as possible to sort of, like, stick it to the voters or whatever. And, like, that's a very John Gruden thing to do, I feel like, number one, like, just to be so petty about something like that.
Right.
But, you know, and then on the other hand, you just look at the moves that the Raiders have made from a running back perspective, this offseason, they re-signed Jalen Richard, who's a pass-catching first back. They draft Lynn Bowden and declare him a running back. He's a college pass catcher. So another body there. Then they've got a guy in Devontae Booker, who's a third down back. They also add him to the roster. And now you have Theo Riddick, and we know that Theo Riddick is just – I mean, I don't know that he's one of the best pass-catching running backs in the NFL because he's just sort of like a catch-and-fall, you know, around-the-line-of-scrimmage type right. of guy. Who knows? He might not even make the roster, number one. Like, let's be clear about that. But it's just odd that the one question that we all have about Josh Jacobs, which is how many times are they going to throw him the football, they continue to seem to make moves that answer it being not very much because we have all of these other backs to do it. But I mean, Jacobs is the supreme talent, one of the best young backs in the league, so he could easily make all these guys irrelevant, but I think it would be something that would be very foolish to ignore sort of the trend of all of these other backfield moves.
Yep. I basically said that throughout the offseason, that we can hear that Mike Mayock says he's going to be involved more in the passing game all we want, but at the same time, you have to look at everyone that they've added to this roster, and everything screams that this is going to be I don't even know how they're going to disperse targets. It's honestly one of the toughest situations to project when you sit down and do projections because we know that this offense has revolved around the tight end position quite a bit. Henry Ruggs was used with the number 12 overall pick. As Matt stated, there's a lot of other running backs in this roster. I just don't see Josh Jacobs ever getting to the territory where he's catching 60 balls like he talked about. I think it's I think that the best case scenario for Jacobs right now, and it's nothing to do with his ability, but it has to do with the situation. I think it's like a Joe Mixon type season, and that's like a low-end RB1, high-end RB2. I don't think this offense presents enough scoring opportunities for him to finish as a top six running back. So drafting him as, you know, the eighth running back off the board, the seventh running back off the board, which I've seen some people do, I think you're drafting him at a ceiling right now. So unfortunately, unless Jacobs falls towards the end of the second round, mid to late second round, I'm not going to own any Jacobs.
It's super confusing because you're looking at all the guys that they've added, and you even have, I mean, Matt listed off all the running backs. You also have Rod Smith on this roster too. And looking at it, and like, you have four of the same type of player, right? Theo Riddick, Devontae Booker, Jalen Richard, and I mean, maybe put Lynn Bowden. Lynn Bowden's more of like that electric player. Like, you get him some scheme touches. He's a good receiver out of the backfield too, but can also run between the tackles. But like, the weird thing is that they haven't added a running back to that does the same types of things that Josh Jacobs does. Like, what happens when, if, yeah, exactly. Like, what happens if Josh Jacobs goes down?
They sign Isaiah Crowell.
Great. They just throw like, you know, 10 to 15 pop gun passes to Theo Riddick and Jalen Richard. And like,
right.
You know, I guess it's like the amalgamation of like a running game that's sort of through the passing game, I guess. You're right. I had really never thought about that, Kyle, that like, who is the, you know, number two back here? If like, who's the insurance policy if Jacobs was to ever go down? It's the one of the weirdest offenses just to look at in general. Cause like, if you squint at the receiver core, kind of like Tags was saying, like, it looks like a pretty good group. Like, you could talk yourself into the fact that Darren Waller's the top target there, but, you know, they have a speed guy in Henry Ruggs. They have Tyrell Williams, who I think is one of the more underrated receivers in the league. Brian Edwards keeps getting pop in the offseason, and I think he could fit into sort of that Michael Crabtree back shoulder contested catch receiver as someone that Derek Carr really trusted and gravitated to in the early part of his career. They also still have Hunter Renfrow there. Nelson Aguilar is even getting some pop out of camp. So it's a strange, strange offense all around. And even that alone, like, I just don't know where this offense is going to fall. Is it going to be I don't think it's going to be a great unit, but could it be a very good unit? I could see that. Could it also be just an average to below average unit? And I also just kind of hate taking a running back in an offense where I don't totally know how things are going to play out. So Jacobs is a weird guy for me that I haven't gravitated to, not just because of the individual questions that we talked about, like with the pass catching backs on the roster, you know, taking away some of those touches, just the Raiders in general, I haven't found myself gravitating towards that team. And oh, by the way, like, their early schedule is tough. Like, they have a very difficult way. Like, they start week one against the Carolina Panthers in Carolina, you know, whatever, but then they get the Saints, the Patriots, the Bills, the Chiefs. They get a bye in week six, then the Bucks, the Browns, the Chargers. Like, things don't start to really ease up for a while. They could get off to conceivably, you know, an 0-5 start. That wouldn't surprise me one bit.
Yeah, it all just kind of goes like, when you're using it as a tiebreaker when you're on the clock and you have to choose, am I taking Josh Jacobs at the back end of the first round, or am I going to go with another player who has a little bit more guaranteed involvement, right? That's the thing. Like, Josh Jacobs can absolutely be involved in the passing game. I think it's a very hard path for him to get there, but he has the skill set. I love Josh Jacobs, his film coming out of college from him as a receiving perspective. But if he does not have that path, that guaranteed path, two touches from the receiving game, then it's very difficult to spend that equity on Josh Jacobs at the back end of the first round versus going elsewhere with that pick. All right, guys, enough delaying it. Let's get into this mock draft. We are doing a full PPR Superflex mock draft today. A little bit different than what we've done in the past. Typically, we're doing a full PPR mock draft, or we're doing a half PPR. That's kind of our normal here. We're going Superflex. So, Tags, let's just break down Superflex really quick for those who are listening and have never played the format. How does it change? How does your strategy change in a Superflex?
Yeah, a lot of times analysts around the industry talk about waiting a quarterback and, you know, going late because it's a very replaceable position. Once you move to a two quarterback or a Superflex format, it's a lot different, right? Where these quarterbacks are worth a lot more. So what a Superflex is, it gives you flexibility in your flex spot. So one of the flex spots, you're able to use a quarterback, running back, wide receiver, or tight end. A lot of times you're going to want to use a quarterback because the floor of those guys is much higher than a lot of the flex type players. So it's almost like the draft strategy. I'm going to love talking through this one because we do a lot of mock drafts, but not a lot of super flex. So this is where we can explain our strategy as we work through it. Make sure we don't get stuck with someone like, maybe like a Sam Darnold is our second quarterback. I love these formats. I urge you, even if you don't want to play for money with your friends or anything like that, if you don't want to do that, if you just want to do it for fun, try it out. I promise you, super flex leagues are a whole lot of fun because it makes the quarterback position relevant again. Because like in one quarterback leagues, they just don't have a whole lot of reliability. So I look forward to this draft with you guys.
For sure. All right, well, let's kick this off here, Tags. We are doing, obviously, the super flex, we mentioned that, and then two running back, three wide receiver, a tight end, a flex, which is the wide receiver, running back, or tight end. Then obviously we have the super flex there. And then how many bench spots, Tags? Six?
Six bench spots. We're not going to do any kickers or defense because, again, all of us will be waiting until the final round anyway, so it doesn't really make all that much sense.
Yep. All right, guys, I have the 101. Awesome. Tags has the 105, and then Matt is down at the 110. So I'm going to talk through my strategy for the 101 and how that changes in a Superflex. Again, if you've never played a Superflex, you're going to see that quarterbacks go a lot earlier than you're anticipating, right? And we did a mock draft recently, I think it was last week's, right, Tags, where we saw Lamar Jackson and Patrick Mahomes both go within the first round of a one quarterback league. Obviously, you're going to see those guys go really, really early, potentially at the 101, but then also looking at, you're going to see some other quarterbacks. You're going to see probably Dak Prescott, Kyler Murray, both go off the board in the first round too. So this kind of pushes the quarterback position, the value up, and then brings some of the other value down. So guys, I'm looking here at the 101. Obviously, Lamar Jackson and Patrick Mahomes are in play for me, but even in a super flex format, it is very, very difficult for me to pass on Christian McCaffrey and what he can do at the running back position. I believe that I can double up on quarterback later on and take advantage of those guys there. But looking at Christian McCaffrey and especially this defense, they're in a rebuild. And so you're looking at the offense going to be passing the ball a ton this season. That just means even more yardage and opportunities for Christian McCaffrey out of the backfield with Teddy Bridgewater at quarterback. I'm taking Christian McCaffrey here at the 101.
Yeah, I mean, Matt, is that what you would do in a super flex format? I'm with Yates in this one, where I'd be taking McCaffrey as well. It's just too much positional value to replace.
Yeah, I think, I mean, we could talk about the fact that obviously the quarterback position gets a boost in super flex. I agree with that. But at the same time, there's still far more value in these unicorn running backs. And obviously McCaffrey is at the top of everybody's list this year. So that is the way I would have gone too.
Yeah, this is where it gets tough for me. I have the 105 pick, and Mahomes came off the board number 2, Saquon Barkley at 3, Ezekiel Elliott in 4. I was really hoping that Lamar Jackson would go in one of those top 4 picks, so I didn't have to
contemplate. So you have to think about it.
Yeah, I wouldn't even have to think about it. It would have been nice because I would have gotten Zeke or Saquon there at 5. Right now, I'm a little torn because I do like Alvin Kamara quite a bit. Dalvin Cook with the injury situation. Adam Schefter on ESPN actually mentioned the other day, said that if Dalvin Cook doesn't have a contract, he'd be a little hesitant about drafting him right now. So that makes me want to stay away from Dalvin Cook. Michael Thomas, we obviously know he's worth something, but running backs are just too valuable this year. I always end up hating my team if I go quarterback in the first round, so I'm going to stick with my guns here, and I'm going to say that I'm going to take Alvin Kamara, despite the fact that 96% of experts are telling me that I should be taking Lamar Jackson here. I just I do not want to be left in a hole at running back, so I'm going to take Alvin Kamara. Did I make the right choice, guys, first off?
Yeah,
I personally would have gone with Lamar Jackson just because I did not expect him to even be there at the 105, yeah. Because I thought he was going to go 102. But then with Patrick Mahomes going off the board, and it all depends on how you want to build your roster, right? And I think even in a super flex, to have Alvin Kamara and his obviously a bounce back season. Last year his numbers were down, still finishes the RB12, but his numbers were down. And so if he can bounce back into this guy who is a top four, top five, potentially even top three running back, then you're not going to be upset with your pick because, again, there are some good values at the quarterback position later on. Okay, Matt, you're on the clock. We saw Lamar Jackson go at the 106, Deshaun Watson at the 107, Dak Prescott at the 108, and then Michael Thomas at the 109. Who are you going with here at the 110?
Yeah, God, I really hate the position I'm in here.
Yes, yes.
Because, you know, right, again, I'm not really thinking about any of these other quarterbacks right now. I would have maybe given some thought to Dak there, but that's not going to happen. Michael Thomas also would have been in consideration here. So now I'm starting to look at, do I take Davante Adams, who's my number one receiver, and it's a PPR format. So am I going that way, or am I going to go with the last? And I have this running back in tier one, and it's Derrick Henry. I know it's PPR. Mm-hmm. He has 18 catches, a career high last year. I think there's no way he doesn't, you know, beat that this year. Not only do I expect the fact that the Titans are going to throw the ball more, I also think, you know, rookie Darrington Evans is coming on slow in camp. Deion Lewis is out of the picture. I know it's very foolish to sit here and say, okay, I'm going to project this player to be used in a way that he has never been used before, which is being featured as a pass catcher. Mm-hmm. But I just think there's almost no way that he doesn't beat that. By the way, still has as much upside as anybody to lead the NFL in rushing yards, rushing touchdowns, right, carries, and everything like that. So
yeah, and Matt, you lucked out here. I mean, yeah, you see who's on the board for you at 203, right?
I do.
You made your pick, and I'm mad about it because Matt is the guest. I'm supposed to beat Matt, and well, you can go ahead and talk about your number one wide receiver, which, by the way, I do not think is a crazy take. Some people have told me it's crazy to put them in the same tier, but you have Davante Adams as your wide receiver one.
I do have Davante Adams as my wide receiver one because I think the unique confluence of events that led to Thomas being a record-breaking wide receiver one last year, I think all those are in play for Adams this year. Yep. He's pretty much the only game in town. It's a little concerning that he's had some injury issues in camp, but nothing that's too major. You always want your players coming in with like a clean bill, nothing going wrong there. But nevertheless, I think Adams is the odds-on favorite to lead the NFL in targets and touchdowns this year. So I take him here, and I feel pretty good about it.
I mean, Yates.
Yeah, if you're looking at taking him there at the 110 and he falls to you at the 203, you got to take him. So right. We saw Kyler Murray go off the board again. I'm just going to be highlighting some of these quarterbacks as they go off the board. So Kyler Murray, Russell Wilson. So again, just to highlight the uniqueness of a super flex format, we've already got Mahomes, Lamar Jackson, Deshaun Watson, Dak Prescott, Kyler Murray, and Russell Wilson off the board by the 201. Now, we haven't seen a quarterback go after Matt's pick at the 203. We saw Julio, Austin Eckler, Miles Sanders, and Aaron Jones. So a little run on running backs there. Tags, you're up at the 208. Where are you going?
Yeah, this is a tough spot for me. I have two running backs on the board that I absolutely love in Kenyon Drake and Joe Mixon, and I've kind of flip-flopped them through the ranking process as we've gone through the offseason because we're hearing more and more about Joe Mixon, about how Zach Taylor, they kind of realized halfway through the season that Joe Mixon, they needed to do their best job at getting the ball in his hands. And Joe Burrow, being a rookie quarterback, as much as I do like him as a player and I think he's going to be absolutely fine, I think Joe Mixon's the featured guy in this offense, and it's difficult not to like him. I do love Kenyon Drake, but it's really tough to pass on the guaranteed production out of Joe Mixon because we've never seen, as much as I do like Drake, the only concern that we do have about him is that he's never been a featured back over an entire season. So Joe Mixon has clearly showed the ability. He's in a contract year. There's a lot of things to like about Mixon. So I'm going to take Joe Mixon here just because I feel a little bit safer with him, but I have him and Drake in that same exact tier.
All right, so after Tags' pick of Mixon, DeAndre Hopkins went off the board. Kenyon Drake, Chris Godwin, I am now up at the 212. And here is the issue, okay? So I've got Christian McCaffrey. Okay, that's great. Yep. But then I hate picking at the turn because looking at, I now have to set the runs rather than take advantage. With what Tags can do now with the way that he's constructed his roster, he can let these players kind of fall to him. With me, I don't pick again, right, for quite a while. So I have to be taking a quarterback here at this spot. I have to start the run because otherwise I'm going to be looking at Tom Brady as my quarterback one in a super flex. I don't know if I feel super comfortable with that. And maybe even Tom Brady's off the board by that point. Yeah. So looking at the 212 here, I am going to be taking a quarterback. The top one that the experts are recommending is Josh Allen. I love Allen for fantasy football. We can talk all we want about his actual quarterback play, but getting Stephon Diggs is certainly going to help. And when Josh Allen can present as much rushing upside as he does, to get him here at the 212 in a super flex as my quarterback one, I am fine with that.
Yeah, Josh Allen is someone that's a little bit up and down in production. He's obviously a perfect candidate like for best ball formats if you guys do some best ball. I just worry about the defense being so good. Did you realize there was not a single – I actually found this earlier today. Josh Allen did not have a single game where he threw for more than 266 yards last year. So basically, those nine rushing touchdowns that he had were carrying a lot of his fantasy performances. And now that you have, you know, Zach Moss on the roster, he's probably a better version of Frank Gore at this point in their careers. And then – this defense is still really good. They didn't really lose anybody of significance, so I think it's possible they even take a step forward. I think that's why Buffalo is obviously the favorite there in the AFC East now. Matt, where are you at on Josh Allen this year?
Man, I gave a small bit of consideration to taking Josh Allen at my second round pick because I'm really high on Allen this year. I'm really high on this Bills offense. I think they have changed the complexion of this offense so dramatically over the course of Allen's career. I mean, his rookie year, the top three targeted players on that team were Zay Jones, Kelvin Benjamin, and LaShawn McCoy. Yep. What a disaster. Like now you're looking at Stephon Diggs, John Brown, Cole Beasley, maybe the third most targeted guy there. That's a really good setup. So I think that Allen can make some progress as a passer just from an efficiency perspective, but also from a raw numbers perspective. I think that leap could happen this year. Also, the rushing upside, I think, gives him easy access to be a top three quarterback in fantasy this year. So I really like taking Allen, just can't really stomach it, even in a super flex format. Like I said, gave some small consideration to taking him at my last spot, but just too much like upside with Adams or other running backs there to really do it.
Yeah, no, I mean, Allen, it's in Superflex, you're going to start these guys every single week, so you're going to get those boom performances, so it's really going to help. I think he's more valuable in a Superflex than he is in a one quarterback, to be honest. Yates, you finished it up. You grabbed a wide receiver, obviously trying to even out that roster with Tyreek Hill. So, you know, Christian McCaffrey, Tyreek Hill, that's a start you don't get in regular formats, but a Superflex, you're able to make that happen with Josh Allen. Are you feeling good after those first three picks?
I am. I honestly did not expect Tyreek Hill to still be there at the 301. Now, we've talked about it, we've talked about it, Tags, with the boom bust and everything in between, that like Tyreek Hill doesn't exactly present week in and week out consistency, but his big blow up performances can absolutely win you a week. So now that I've taken Tyreek Hill here, I know that I need to double back with either my wide receiver two or my wide receiver three to get a safe option, one that I know doesn't present as much volatility week in and week out. So, but to get Tyreek Hill at the 301, I thought was really good value.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's definitely nice to get him there because you get two of the top five players in their position. This is where it's difficult for me. I think I'm leaning Travis Kelce to get him in the third round at 305. It just feels like too much value to pass up in a PPR format. There's wide receivers on the board that I know a lot of people would be considering, but if I'm talking like legitimately with you guys and I'm saying, hey, you know, if we're in a regular draft, like a regular PPR format, and I get to the end of the second round and Kelsey's there and Galladay's there and guys like that, I'm going to take Kelce. He's just too much guaranteed production there to pass, and I'm at 305. I know in a super flex format, I'm sitting here quarterbackless through three rounds, but I'm okay with it. True. Because when you look at the draft board and you can see who's come off the board, there's only been, what, six quarterbacks that have come off the board now? Seven? I'm okay with it. As long as I get a top 12 quarterback, for my QB1, I'm pretty cool with that. And then we'll talk our way through the strategies as we go through it. But I feel okay with it considering where I'm at in this draft.
For sure. All right. So Travis Kelce, obviously off the board at the 305. Robert Woods went immediately after him. That's a little bit high for Woods, but I obviously love him this year. Adam Thielen at the 307. George Kittle at the 308. And then Nick Chubb at the 309. Again, talking about a super flex and how much it can push down these other positions. Nick Chubb all the way at the back end of the third round. Matt, you're on the clock here at the 310. You don't have a quarterback yet, if memory serves correctly. So where are you going here?
Well, stone worst setup here for me, absolutely. Would have thought about Kittle had he made it to my spot. The wide receivers and running backs I was thinking about there also gone. So I'm gonna default here because I don't love any of the wide receivers left. Certainly don't like the running backs in this range now. So I'm gonna default, take my first quarterback, and it's a boring pick, but it's Matt Ryan. I think the Falcons are gonna lead the NFL in pass attempts, which is sort of an annual situation when Dirk Cutter and Matt Ryan are playing together. Yep. So now I'm kind of stuck back here with, again, looking at some running backs that I don't particularly care for. Don't love the setup even at wide receiver, except one guy I do have my eye on here, with Mike Evans, clearly the top available wide receiver here on my board. I'm going to go with it here because I think he's a value here in the fourth round. And I know people are a little concerned about him playing with Tom Brady because his arm is declining, whatever. But like, Mike Evans has been consistently good his entire career, consistently productive. And I don't really expect that to change just because the best quarterback of all time, despite the fact that he's obviously in a severe decline, is now playing with him in Tampa Bay. I think Evans is still a value this year, especially to get him in the fourth round here.
Yeah, if you're relying on Mike Evans to be your like clear-cut wide receiver one, I think there's room to be concerned. But you're getting him as your wide receiver two behind Davante Adams, right? And you're getting him here in the fourth round. Like, I love that pairing because Evans still does present those huge blow-up weeks. And that's kind of the same thing with Tyreek Hill and what I was talking about. Like, Tyreek Hill, obviously boom or bust, right? He can present some huge weeks. Davante Adams is going to get targeted 11 to 13 times a game. Like, you know, just guaranteed. So Mike Evans can absolutely be a perfect complement to him. All right, so then Odell Beckham off the board at 404. Chris Carson, Juju Smith-Schuster, and then Drew Brees at the 407. Tags, no quarterback still. Are you taking one here?
I'm a little upset that Beckham and Juju went off the board. Those were two guys that I really, really wanted there. To know that I would have waited till the fourth round and got one of them, I would have been psyched about it. My number 12 wide receiver is still on the board, and that's Amari Cooper. I understand that he presents a lot of volatility in a lineup, but when you wait to the fourth round to draft your first wide receiver, I think you have to accept that that's going to be part of it. So I'm going to go ahead and take Amari Cooper to go ahead and pair with my start of Alvin Kamara, Joe Mixon, and Travis Kelce. I'm happy. I mean, considering how long I waited, now granted, quarterback's going to be a rough go. I mean, we're looking at it. Tom Brady just came off the board. Aaron Rodgers came off the board. He was someone that I was actually looking at to draft on the way back around because, again, like Josh Allen, I think Rodgers is better in a super flex format because you just start him every week and you just take what you get out of him, and he's already shown the ability to be a top three fantasy quarterback. So I feel a little bit bad about seeing Rodgers come off the board.
Yeah, so after Cooper, Tom Brady, Todd Gurley, and then obviously Aaron Rodgers, like Tag said. So I'm up at the 412. I'm going to run through the rosters here really quick, guys. I've got Josh Allen, Christian McCaffrey, and Tyreek Hill. And then, of course, I'm on the clock at the 412. Tags has got Alvin Kamara, Joe Mixon, Amari Cooper, and Travis Kelce. And then Matt has Matt Ryan, Derrick Henry, Davante Adams, and Mike Evans. So I'm on the clock, guys. I am looking at the draft board right now, and there is a wide receiver here who I think is a perfect complement to Tyreek Hill. Matt mentioned that Matt Ryan probably going to be in a very good position to lead the league in pass attempts this year. So to get Calvin Ridley here at the 412, I have Calvin Ridley as a top 12 wide receiver this year because based on the pure volume, you're looking at Russell Gage not necessarily going to be a huge factor from the target perspective. Calvin Ridley is just in a prime position to be this guy of Chris Godwin last year, right? You had Mike Evans and Chris Godwin. Now it's Julio Jones and Calvin Ridley in a very pass-happy offense. Calvin Ridley, I absolutely love this year. So to get him as my wide receiver too, I feel like he's a perfect complement to Tyreek Hill. Matt, I heard you exclaim. Are you in agreement with this?
Yeah, I was actually kind of hoping that he would make it to my fifth-round pick. Long shot, but maybe just to have a stack there with Ryan and Calvin Ridley. Now my options to really stack these guys up, especially with my top receivers, obviously are off the board. Their quarterbacks are gone. So was really hoping. Yeah, I mean Calvin Ridley, I think he's locked in. Like, he would be too obvious of a guy to declare a breakout candidate. I mean, he might already be too obvious to call a breakout candidate, but if he had played a full 16 games last year, we would have already been talking about him as that guy. I agree. He is this year's Chris Godwin. It's such an easy analogy to make. Yeah, I'm all in.
Yep.
All right, I'm on the clock at the 501. I am looking at the quarterbacks of Matt Stafford, Daniel Jones, Ben Roethlisberger to potentially take, and even Cam Newton to be my second quarterback. I don't like any of those guys. I like some of the guys that I can get later on. wide receiver. I think I'm good right now, but I'm looking at potentially AJ Brown. But I'm going to take a running back here, guys. I'm going to take Jonathan Taylor. And I'm going to wait on quarterback here. So to go with Jonathan Taylor and Christian McCaffrey as my running back one and running back two, there's talk that Taylor might not be the guy right out of the gate, you know, that he's going to be eased into this offense. The live stream that we did last week, there were a couple of experts that were talking about that possibility. I don't buy it, personally. I think Taylor is going to be this guy that is featured. Now, Mac will still see some touches, and Nyheim Hines is obviously going to be involved. In a full PPR, I'm not super crazy about it, but as my RB2, when I have Christian McCaffrey, who essentially is two running backs in and of himself, you know, to get Jonathan Taylor here as the 501, I'm pretty happy with as my RB2. So after that, we saw Cooper Kupp, Keenan Allen, and DK Metcalf go off the board. Tags, were you eyeing Metcalf there?
I was not. I mean, considering I really wanted Matthew Stafford to fall because, you know, he's just on the cusp of my QB1s. And it was like, okay, if I get him as my QB1, that's like the last. I don't want Daniel Jones as my QB1. I really don't. And I know a lot of people are talking about a potential breakout with him. I don't care. I'm fine with him as your QB2 in a super flex or in a 2QB league, whatever. But Matthew Stafford is a guy that I at least know he's kind of like a Tom Brady in terms of, like, he's not going to kill your fantasy team. He's probably not going to win anything for you, like, single-handedly. But I think he's competent enough. So I was really wanting Stafford to fall, because if he didn't fall there, it was going to get ugly real quick, and I was going to go with somewhat of a zero quarterback approach in a super flex, which really never works out. But guys, I think we need to talk about how we let this happen. Team 9 in this mock draft, right in front of Harmon,
they're crushing it.
This guy has Nick Chubb as his running back, his three wide receivers, Michael Thomas, Julio Jones, and Odell Beckham. And then he just drafted Terry McLaurin as one of his
first picks. I was thinking about Terry at this pick, too. So, I mean, this Team 9 is whooping me over here. I hate this guy.
Oh, man.
I was thinking about that, like, two rounds ago when he had Julio and Michael Thomas. I was like, this is not great. Who is Team 9, and why are they the sharpest person in the room?
Well, they didn't leave you with much to choose from. Matt, where are you going here?
Actually, I'm thinking about two players. One's a quarterback, one's a wide receiver. The wide receiver clearly sticks out as a guy that I'm ahead of the market on. It's Tyler Lockett. I have him as my wide receiver 12 this year. Okay. It's really hard for me to pass him up here. I am thinking about a quarterback, but I'm going to go ahead and make that move because I'm going to trust that I'll like the quarterback options better than I will for filling my third wide receiver spot at the next pick.
Oh, that's definitely fair. Man, Tyler Lockett was someone, if you guys were watching on the YouTube channel, you could actually see the queue because I'm actually the one grabbing this off my screen. So Tyler Lockett was someone in my queue. I thought about last round, but I just couldn't pass on a quarterback. So I definitely dig that pick.
All right. My quarterback is still here. So
there we go.
I'm 603. I'm going to go with Cam Newton here. As my second quarterback. I mean, I think he's the last guy left in my third tier of quarterbacks there. I think there's going to be a drop off, and obviously the ceiling with Cam is just it's great. I don't love the setup of this Patriots offense because, I mean, the skill position players, there are so many questions. Cam Newton's not new to playing in offenses with questionable skill position players. Yeah. Let me tell you that from watching a lot of Panthers football. I also think that they're going to have to ask more out of him than they might have thought, you know, a month and a half ago before all of the, like, some of the big defensive opt-outs that they've had on the other side of the football. Like,
right.
They're not going to be an awful defense, but now I no longer think that they can be, you know, a top five, we'll just lean on our defense type of team. So I think Cam is running away with this quarterback competition in camp. I think he's going to be the starter, and to get him as my second quarterback in a super flex league, now I can just kind of stop having that quarterback anxiety throughout the rest of the draft. I feel really good about that.
I love that pick. I've talked about Cam Newton, you know, if especially from a redraft perspective and, like, in a one quarterback league, if you're going to wait on the position, just draft Cam Newton. He has a good matchup against Miami in week one. You're going to find out if he's fully healthy, which I think he is. All reports are that he is, and that he's back to, you know, his normal self. And then sky's the limit for Cam Newton. Yeah. We've seen it, right? So to have him as, like, your first quarterback in a super flex league, I wouldn't be crazy about. But to get him as your two, I think that's a great move. All right, Tags, you ended up taking a pick here that I did not think you were going to go with. But you took David Johnson here at the 608. Let's talk through that.
Yeah, I did. I was using the pick predictor to actually make this pick. So it's a feature on the Draft Wizard where if you go under it, it'll actually tell you the percentage chance that a player falls back to you during your next pick. So I basically was using that as a reference because the player that I wanted, it was saying that there was a 17% chance that he was drafted before my next pick. And I was willing to take that shot. And I know that running back is going to dry up. And a lot of those guys were slated to come off the board, including David Montgomery. And I knew that Yates was not going to allow David Montgomery to come back to me. So it's part of looking at the draft board, knowing what you're doing, knowing what everybody else is doing. Because I started looking at quarterbacks and I was like, okay, the team's behind me. Team two already has two quarterbacks. Yates, team three and team four, those guys each have one quarterback. So at the very least, like the worst case scenario is that three quarterbacks come off the board. I'm fine with that because I know the tier I'm in with quarterbacks right now. So I wanted to take a position of scarcity before they kind of went dry.
Yeah, David Montgomery went at the 6-11, so thank you very much, Team 2, right before my pick. All right, I am looking at taking a quarterback here, guys, and the top options on the board are Ben Roethlisberger, Baker Mayfield, and Joe Burrow. I'm going to go with Joe Burrow here, and because I think that the skill positions that surround him in this Cincinnati Bengals offense are just too good for him not to be, you know, productive for fantasy football this year. You just simply get the ball into their hands and they're going to be able to create, not to even mention the fact that I love Joe Burrow, the prospect. So to get him here as my quarterback too, I don't think he has a great start to the year as far as a schedule. So I'm going to double back here later on and get a quarterback who I think does have a pretty good start to their schedule, who I know is going to be there. So I can play this game where I can play matchups with my quarterbacks here. That's one thing that we did. I do want to mention too, with a Superflex league, you don't just draft two quarterbacks, right? You need to have at least three on your roster to be able to withstand injuries. Because again, waivers, with the importance of a quarterback in a Superflex league, waivers are going to be super thin. So at least I will be deploying that. I will be drafting a third quarterback later on. Okay. I'm back on the clock at the 7:01. I have Josh Allen, Christian McCaffrey, Jonathan Taylor, Tyreek Hill, Calvin Ridley, and then Joe Burrow as my super flex. And I am looking here at some of the options. I'm not crazy about any of these wide receivers that are on the board. I am going to look at running back, though. This is a little bit early. I'm not super crazy about taking him here, but the payoff is potentially huge, especially in a full PPR format. I'm going to take Kareem Hunt. And looking at Kareem Hunt as a flex option or someone who can be on my bench if I grab another running back later on that I like, or a wide receiver too, that I can plug in. And then if something happens to Nick Chubb, I think he is a top five running back. So Nick, especially too in a PPR format, Kareem Hunt is going to be the pass catcher in this backfield. I think he can have standalone value. So Kareem Hunt here at the beginning of the seventh round. Tags, what do you think about taking Kareem Hunt there?
I dig it. I mean, in a flex spot, that's ideally where you have him, just because he offers flex usability on a week-to-week basis. And if something were to happen to Nick Chubb, which we already saw him leave practice once this preseason, training camp, whatever you want to call it, he has top five upside. Like, that's league-winning upside. So drafting him over someone like, you know, Jordan Howard or Cam Akers, I believe there's more league-winning potential in someone like Kareem Hunt than those guys, even as a handcuff. So I definitely dig Kareem Hunt. I think that he should be going around that RB 25, 26 range. So in the top of the seventh round, I'm good with it.
All right, and then we saw two tight ends go off the board in between my and Tag's pick. Evan Engram, Darren Waller, and then Baker Mayfield off the board at the 7:04. Tags, where are you going here at the 7:05?
This is where I'm going to get a little, I mean, it could be called greedy or whatever, but I'm going to take my guy rather than going off of, again, the experts are telling me to draft T.Y. Hilton here. I appreciate T.Y. Hilton for what he has been, but he's been injured off and on. The quarterback situation is questionable at best. Instead, I'm going to take the other veteran who went on the field, has been better than T.Y. Hilton, has a better quarterback coming to town, and that's A.J. Green. To get A.J. Green in the seventh round, I love A.J. Green. I really do. And I understand that people are worried about the injuries. We talked to Dr. David Chow on the show last week, and he basically let us know that he would not be afraid to draft A.J. Green based on what happened last year, that there were many factors that went into him missing the entire season, and that, you know, when on the field, A.J. Green, he's in the same year as Julio Jones, so don't call him old. You know, Julio Jones is still being drafted as a top three wide receiver. A.J. Green is fantastic when on the field, and I understand that there is some risk involved, but that's heavily baked in at round 7 ADP right now.
Matt, where are you at on AJ Green this year? Let's just talk about this super quick before we move to your pick.
Yeah, I think he's pretty much just an impossible eval, like knowing what he's got left, because we've just totally missed an entire season with him. However, that being said, last time we saw him in 2018, he was still pretty good. I don't think he was peak AJ Green, but he was a pretty good player, which is, you know, like Tag said, this is a pretty reasonable range to take that kind of risk.
For sure. All right.
I'm on the
Christian
clock.
Kirk. Yep, Christian Kirk, T.Y. Hilton, Ben Roethlisberger, Jimmy Garoppolo in between Tags and Matt's pick. Matt, you're on the clock. Where are you going?
Yeah, Team 9. Thanks a lot. You didn't make that one hard for me, taking Jimmy Garoppolo there. What's up, buddy? This is a tough spot, though, for me, honestly. You know, there's a couple of my guy type running backs left. I mean, type wide receivers left. I'm going to take the risk, though, that they fall to me. And I'm going to take Ronald Jones here. I never thought I would be into Ronald Jones at all, but at the same time, and I just got a slight reach. There was a 100%, near 100% chance that Ronald Jones would have been available at your next pick. Okay, whatever. I don't need this draft. I don't need this draft talking smack to me over here. To be fair, the wide receiver I really wanted to come back to me got taken by Team 12. I really wanted Marquise Brown there, so maybe I should have gone that way. But wanted to get a solid guy at my second running back spot. Never thought I'd be in on Ronald Jones, but I think the positives are starting to outweigh the negatives with Ronald Jones. Like, you might think he's not going to be a good player. Totally fair. At the same time, he's looks like the clear-cut number one starting running back on an offense that I expect to be one of the better offenses in the NFL. The coaching staff seems to be behind him. I think the positives are way outweighing the negatives here with Jones at this point.
Mm-hmm. And well, as your RB2, do you feel okay about that, or do you wish you would have gone differently at a different point in the draft?
No, I mean, at this point, obviously, like, I've accepted that my second running back spot is not going to be that great, but I feel solid with my wide receivers, especially with top running back and also my two quarterbacks. So yeah, that's just going to be the weaker point of my roster, and you know, that is what it is. Yeah. I'm on the clock again, 8:03. Tyler Boyd and Marquise Brown were two receivers that went ahead of me, and I'm going to go aggressive here and at wide receiver, and I'm going to go with Will Fuller. Excited about Fuller's opportunity this year, excited about the player. Obviously, we know the injury risk, yada, 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 but he has, like, clear top 10, top 15 upside when he is on the field, and now he gets to play without DeAndre Hopkins. And you could argue that, you know, might be a slight negative even, because defenses were really put in a bind when they had Fuller on one side of the field and they had Hopkins on the other side of the field. That's a lot. You know, you're sort of having to pick and choose your poison there, because Fuller's just – you have to dictate extra defensive attention to that guy, because he's just going to rip you apart otherwise. We've seen that happen. Now I think there's still – now if, like, Cooks and Stills and Randall Cobb and some of these other guys are on the field, defenses can't totally just key in on Will Fuller. So I think he's in a prime spot. Obviously, there's just the injury risk there.
Yeah, I mean, if you're – and put this into consideration, you're taking Will Fuller as your flex. Right. So he's not someone that you're necessarily relying on as, like, a wide receiver too. Right. If you waited super, you know, long on wide receiver, you're going to be able to take him out if you see that this is a matchup that he has a, you know, top tier corner on, or if it's a matchup that's going to be high scoring, plug him in. Cause the boom potential there is incredible. Tags, you took a quarterback here at the 808. You went with Gardner Minshew. Let's talk about that.
I did. I was worried that Team 9 was really going to give it to me, but they went with Kirk Cousins. I really love Gardner Minshew in two quarterback formats. I think that he's one of the most undervalued assets in that format. I believe there's an outside chance that he finishes as a top 12 quarterback this year. I think the rushing floor is there with him, and that's really what I want out of my second quarterback slot. I want a guy that could present some sort of floor with his rushing ability, and I also want a guy that's locked into the starting job, has zero competition. Minshew fits everything that I absolutely want. They did ask add LaVisca Chenault to the offense. DJ Chark is showing out. Jay Gruden is a better play caller than what they've had there. So Minshew, I do like a lot. I think he's playing for another team next year. This is a team that I expect them to fully have that number one draft pick next year. So Minshew, you know, like a Jameis Winston light this year, that's very possible, with a little lesser wide receiver core, obviously. But this is how I approach, you know, two quarterback super flex drafts, is that I go and I draft players. Like, I do it by tiers, and I say, I just don't want to miss out. I think Minshew, Kirk Cousins, that's where I don't want to miss out. That's like the end of the QB2 run. Fortunately, I have Minshew higher than most. So getting him here in eighth round, I feel awesome about it.
Nice. All right, I went with Jamison Crowder here at I went with Jamison Crowder here at the 8-12, and I picked Crowder over Deontay Johnson, who I was considering, because I was looking at my wide receiver core, where I have Tyreek Hill and Calvin Ridley. Now, I think Calvin Ridley is an absolutely safe option, and I think he's going to be heavily targeted. But looking at Jamison Crowder in a full PPR, we're talking about one of these guys who could be the most targeted receiver in the NFL because there is absolutely no one else in this Jets receiving room. And the Adam Gase offenses clearly love the slot receiver. You're talking about Denzel Mims starting off the season slow. Rashad Perryman's dealing with his own injuries. I mean, who else is in this wide receiver room, guys? They're working out Kevin White, for goodness sake. So Jamison Crowder here at the 8-12, I like it, because especially in a full PPR, because he's just going to soak up targets in this offense.
Yeah, Crowder, I started looking at the week one matchups, and he's going to be playing against the Bills, a team that hasn't traditionally been a team that you want to pass the ball on. But if there's one guy in that lineup that I do think has a plus matchup, it's Jamison Crowder against Teron Johnson. So he can get off to a fast start, because of the top three wide receiver performances against the Bills last year, Jamison Crowder had two of them. So that could be a quick start for him, especially knowing that Perriman and Mims are new guys in the roster that, you know, Darnold hasn't worked with very much.
Yeah. All right, well, I took DeAndre Swift here at the 901 to be my fourth running back at this point. So this guy who I can absolutely plug in as a flex option or rotate him in on bye weeks, DeAndre Swift's going to, I think he's going to be the lead guy in this backfield. I love Swift coming out from Georgia, loved his talent and loved his film. So to get him here at the start of the ninth round, I think is incredible to be my depth, you know, running back at this point. So all right, and then we saw Sterling Shepard, Jerry Jeudy, Raheem Mostert go off the board in between Tags' pick. Tags, you took a Pittsburgh wide receiver. Who'd you take?
I did, and I'm so thankful that you left him there for me. Jamison Crowder is a fine PPR add, but knowing what I have at wide receiver, knowing it was Amari Cooper and AJ Green, that there's some question marks around both of those guys, I wanted an upside player at wide receiver three that could potentially deliver more. And Deontay Johnson, I don't think many people realize that he led the NFL among perimeter wide receivers in yards of separation at target, and that's despite having crap quarterback play. Deontay Johnson's a guy that Ben Roethlisberger's talked up, says that he talks to him almost every day. He's been calling him, asking him for tips. He wants to get in his quarterback's ear, which is always a good thing. So getting him in the ninth round, I mean, I'm curious. Matt, you're the wide receiver guru. Matt does this reception perception series that's fantastic. He walks through wide receivers. What's your take on Deontay Johnson? Do you see him as a real potential breakout candidate?
Absolutely. Was my biggest riser coming out of the reception perception process, like after putting the 50 guys through the process this year. He was the one who really took a leap for me. I didn't know too much about him. Obviously knew who he was, knew, you know, seen him play, whatever, but he was way better than I expected. 88th percentile success rate versus man coverage. When you start to get that high, wow, in reception perception, your chances of having a 1,000-yard season at some point in your career are extremely likely based on the historical data. So yeah, I'm totally with you, man. Totally in on Deontay Johnson this year. I was hoping he would make it back to my pick and was considering at my last spot too.
Nice. Well, it makes me happy to hear that you are high on him, because obviously your opinion does mean a lot. Are you going to be looking to add more wide receivers? It looks like you just drafted a running back, that one that I'm a little torn on. So I want to hear your process on selecting Cam Akers at the 9-10 pick.
You know, I did not expect to be in on Cam Akers either, but the Daryl Henderson injury recently does, I think, push Akers up a little bit for me. Like, I had those guys essentially neck and neck, yep, going into this weekend. Now I think Henderson might see himself sort of fall behind in that committee. So I'm willing to take Akers here. Like, I hate the idea of Akers as a round five selection. And that's usually like right around where, right, his ADP, mm-hmm, is in some formats. So I hate him there. But to take him in the ninth round here, I think it's just, again, there's some potential there for him to way out kick where I just drafted him. And he's my number three running back, a weaker spot on my team right now. So I don't mind taking the risk here.
That's fair. And this is the point in the draft where, again, you're down there, you waited at running back, you need some players that could potentially live up to that every week startability. And Cam Akers can fit that if Sean McVay does decide to change his offense once again.
Yeah. And I'm back on the clock here too. You know, no one to, like, CeeDee Lamb, Tariq Cohen, John Brown, Henry Ruggs. Wasn't really thinking about any of those guys here. Now I'm sort of thinking, do I continue to beef up wide receiver? Do I take a tight end here? Because I don't have one yet. But I'm going to take the last quarterback that I sort of see as an appealing fantasy option here, because I don't think they're making it back to me on my next pick. And I'm going to take Teddy Bridgewater. I think Teddy's got good job security in Carolina. Also think Carolina's going to be throwing the ball. Kyle mentioned up top with Christian McCaffrey, they're going to be throwing the ball a lot this year. Number one, because, yeah, they have an aggressive offensive coach who I think, you know, calls plays the right way. You know, it's a projection, but coming from that Saints system in LSU last year, I like what Joe Brady has to offer. And their defense is just going to, I mean, it's going to be like the worst defense in the league. So Teddy's going to be throwing the ball a lot. Love the skill position players in Carolina. I really think they're an underrated crew. So taking him as my third quarterback here and locking in the option, you know, if something doesn't work out with Cam or just, you know, don't like the matchup with Cam that week, I think I can throw Teddy in there and he has a pretty good ceiling each and every week because of how much you're going to throw.
Mm-hmm. I agree. And he takes care of the football too, right? And that's one of the things that with a like a Jameis Winston, right, where they're going to be throwing the ball a ton, well, then he's also throwing a ton of interceptions. I don't see that happening with Teddy Bridgewater. So this is a guy that I love as a QB3 in a super flex league. I'm going to run through the rosters here really quick. So Matt, you've got Matt Ryan as your quarterback, Derrick Henry, Cam Akers as your running backs, and then of course Derrick Henry and then Ronald Jones and then Cam Akers. And then Devontae Adams, Mike Evans, Tyler Lockett, Will Fuller. And then on your bench, you have Cam Newton and Teddy Bridgewater. Obviously, you'd move one of those guys in for your super flex. And then tags, you have, let me pull this up, you have Matthew Stafford and Gardner Minshew as your quarterbacks, Alvin Kamara, Joe Mixon, and David Johnson as your running backs, Amari Cooper, AJ Green, Deontay Johnson, and Jalen Reagor, who you just took here at the 10:08, and then Travis Kelce as your tight end. Let's talk through that Jalen Reagor pick really quick while I figure out who the heck I'm going to draft.
Jalen Reagor is one of the best kept secrets in fantasy football right now, as far as I'm concerned. You know, DeSean Jackson, obviously a veteran, but 34 years old, you know, never a high volume guy. You have Zach Ertz dealing with some sort of injury throughout training camp. I don't know what it is. But Jalen Reagor, they've done is talk this kid up. I mean, even going back to before training camp started, in offseason workout programs that they did, they said Reagor is more than they had thought he would be. And then now you have Carson Wentz comparing him to like a Julio Jones, which is crazy. Like, don't do that.
Carson, like, come back to us, bro. Yeah.
That's a little bit too far. But Jalen Reagor is someone that I absolutely loved. He was my number three wide receiver in this class. And to know that the opportunity is there for him, like there's a clear cut opportunity for him to get 100 targets in this offense. So to get him in the 10th round, I am stoked about it, especially, you know, considering I did wait at wide receiver.
All right, at the 10-12, I took Hayden Hurst here as my tight end. To get Hayden Hurst all the way at the back end of the 10th round, who I have as a top six tight end this year, again, it's based on this pure passing volume. And looking at the opportunity in this offense, I'm investing. You know, for fantasy football purposes, I'm investing in this offense. So Hayden Hurst as my tight end on this roster. And then I'm looking at my options here. I want a third quarterback, right? I talked about this earlier where I want a third quarterback to pair with Joe Burrow, who has a little bit of a rough start to the schedule. And I'm looking at Sam Darnold is there. I really don't want any piece of this Jets offense other than Jamison Crowder. Nick Foles is not a guarantee to start week one. Dwayne Haskins has Alex Smith coming back, so I don't even know if he's a guarantee to start. Ryan Fitzpatrick is there, but the guy who I'm going to take who has a great start to the schedule, it's Tyrod Taylor, and it's not necessarily a sexy pick, right, especially here in the 11th round, but Tyrod Taylor, from a fantasy football perspective, where he's going to be running the ball, he's a mobile quarterback, he's going to pick up these yards, he has a great surrounding cast around him with guys like Keenan Allen, Hunter Henry, you know, Mike Williams is going to be involved, Austin Eckler out of the backfield, obviously. Tyrod Taylor can be a fine quarterback too to plug in and play this streaming matchup game. I've got two guys in the same game, right, week one. I've got the Chargers and the Cincinnati Bengals up against one another. Bengals are going to be a suspect defense to start the year. I don't think they get clicking until the end of the year, if that. So Tyrod Taylor here at the start of the 11th round as my quarterback three. I personally like it. Let's hear what you guys think. Would you go Tyrod?
I think you're going to have trouble figuring out who you're going to start. I mean, you have Tyrod against Joe Burrow in week one. I'm guessing you're probably going to start Tyrod in that matchup. The Chargers are not a great defense to go against. So I actually dig this one. I think you're going to spot start him more. I think he's going to be more than just an injury insurance. I think you're going to start him a couple times. So I dig the pick there. Matt, are you – I've been on record, and I said with Yates, is that I would rather draft Tyrod Taylor than I would Daniel Jones this year. And the reason I'm saying that is because Daniel Jones, you can't use the first three. I'm not playing him against Pittsburgh. Really not doing
right,
it.
Right, right.
And Tyrod plays Cincinnati, so at least he's usable in week one.
Honestly, I might be crazy, but I think the whole Chargers offense is underrated. Like, if Tyrod is the quarterback that he was when he was originally starting in Buffalo and, like, you know, just a safe, careful guy, I really think that this team could pop because they have so much talent at the skill position spots. I mean, Mike Williams' injury is a little bit problematic, but at the same time, like, Keenan Allen's a proven number one receiver, one of the best separators in the NFL. Austin Eckler, I think, I think he could take that Christian McCaffrey leap. Like, remember when we all used to thought, like, oh, Christian McCaffrey, he can't be a three down back. Then boom, he's out there popping at the best running back in the league. I think Eckler could take that step this year while still maintaining, obviously, some of the targets. Some of it's going to come down because Taylor's going to run the ball more. They're going to probably be a little bit more run heavy, but you know, people are projecting him to lose like 100 pass attempts off Phillip Rivers' total last year. I think it could be more, you know, I think we could easily see 50. I think we could see 50 fewer pass attempts, but I'm not going crazy with it. I love Tyrod as an early streaming quarterback. Don't expect him to start all year, but this coaching staff is in on him. They really like him too. So I think that gives him some extra job security. Yeah, I think the whole Chargers outfit is underrated at this point.
All right, middle of the 11th round, Tags, you went with J.K. Dobbins, one of my favorite insurance running backs this year, but he could have some standalone value. So let's talk about J.K. Dobbins really quick, and then Matt is on the clock with 15 seconds left.
Yeah, Dobbins is someone that I like as a bench stash. I don't want to rely on him as a starter, but I've been saying that is like once you get outside that starting lineup, start racking up the upside. You know, Jalen Reagor on my bench, J.K. Dobbins on my bench. I know they're rookies, and a lot of people don't want to consider those guys, but if you look at last year, the rookie class, what those guys did, I'm not saying this rookie class was supposed to be better than last year's, but with the lack of preseason, I think it's going to take some time, especially with someone like Dobbins, where they do trust Mark Ingram. Rager's going to be forced in regardless. So Dobbins is one of the best high upside guys to have on your bench because he eventually should and could take over that job in Baltimore, which we know is very valuable.
Matt, you went with a tight end here that I have ranked as my tight end 10 in half PPR formats, and let me tell you this, I don't feel great about it, but you're looking at an opportunity in an offense. Mike Gesicki off the board at the 11-10. Let's talk about Mike Gesicki here.
Yeah, Gesicki was a guy, like all my tight end options that I was considering were there for me. I have him at tight end 8. I'm really excited about Gesicki this year. I think we already saw him flash last year. I expect him to continue to get a lot of reps out of the slot, which is key with Albert Wilson and Allen Hurns both opting out this year. Isaiah Ford is like their only natural slot receiver left. I like Ford as like a super, super deep sleeper too, by the way. But, you know, nevertheless, just looking at what was left on the board here, I felt pretty comfortable going in that range with him.
Yeah, I mean, again, I mentioned it, opportunity galore, right? You're looking at an offense that has Devontae Parker and Preston Williams, and then that's about it. And Preston Williams potentially starting out slow to start the season. So, all right, Robbie Anderson, Preston Williams, we just talked about him, went off the board. Jared Cook, Jonnu Smith. Matt, you have 3 seconds left on the clock. Who are we going with here at the 12:03?
Where is my stupid pick that I wanted to make here? Oh, okay, there it is. Hang on. Don't screw me here. Oh, well, I think I just clocked myself out.
I mean, is Matt Breida, is it really that bad of a pick right there at 12:03?
No, I was considering between Breida, Tevin Coleman, and another running back there, which I'll save. So, yeah, I mean, and Coleman went off the board team 6. So, yeah, whatever. That's fine. Who cares?
We won't talk about Matt Breida too much at this point. I mean, but at the same time, you did go with a late running back approach, someone that might, you know, be the primary pass catcher there. Not a bad play.
I was just about to say pass catching, you know, in a full PPR. Worse. That's kind of what you want here. Yeah.
I'm going to take the last. You love to stack Dolphins players here.
Right. I am going to take the last guy that I believe that has a starting job all year, and that's Dwayne Haskins. Obviously, he took some steps forward after a rough start to his career, and it was really a bad situation that he was thrust into. But now, I know Alex Smith was cleared for football activities, but again, we had Dr. Chow on the show last week, and he said that Alex Smith, there's a long road for him, and that he doesn't see it anytime soon for him getting on for the sure. field. We all root for Alex Smith. It's just such a great story. But at the same time, Dwayne Haskins is my QB3. I am cool with that because, again, it's just one of those guys where it's like if there's a bye week or whatever the case may be, if I need to plug him in, I feel like I'll be all right.
All right, I am on the clock at the 12:12. I'm looking at my roster. I'm pretty loaded on running back, but I'm looking at wide receiver, though. There's some guys that are dart throws at best. I'm not loving the wide receiver room here at the back end of the 12th round. But if I am looking at investing and kind of providing insurance for my pick in the first round of Tyreek Hill, Mecole Hardman is
third round. If you took Tyreek Hill in the first round.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Yes. My first wide receiver is what I was trying to say. And I'm looking at Mecole Hardman here. Hardman, obviously, if Sammy Watkins is struggling this year, or even if Tyreek Hill misses time, I've got a guy who I can plug into one of the most prolific offenses in the NFL. So Hardman as my wide receiver 4, I'm not super crazy about. I'm hoping that he takes a significant step forward. But when I'm looking at some of the other guys on the clock of like maybe an Alan Lazard would be in consideration there for me. N'Keal Harry, I really don't want any part of N'Keal Harry. Breshad Perriman, kind of the same thing, already dealing with injury. These guys are just ones that I really don't want to invest in. So I'll take the shot with Mecole Hardman there. And then I'm back on the clock and I am looking for a wide receiver here. I'm going to go with DeSean Jackson. And at this point, I'm looking for these guys who could potentially hit. We saw what DeSean Jackson could do even in one game last year in this offense. And he's going to be needed, right? And it's kind of the reason why Tags loves Jalen Reagor, not just from his talent perspective, because I think he is very talented, but it's looking at the opportunity in this offense. And so if I can get DeSean Jackson healthy, then I think he absolutely can be someone that I can plug into my flex or even my wide receiver spot and be happy that I started him here. So again, not a guarantee that he's going to play all 16 games, but at this point of the draft, every wide receiver comes with question marks.
Did we offer any analysis that at in the 12th round, Team 2 took Taysom Hill?
That's crazy.
I didn't even see that. There we go.
Team 2 just went completely off the range here.
So wait, Matt, you're at Yahoo. Is Taysom Hill going to have eligibility at tight end? Is that a real thing?
I can't do anything about it, but I would have said like not on my watch. I wrote an article for the site that said like you should not be allowed to play, because every time Taysom Hill pops off, you know, you get goofballs in the fantasy mentions like talking about how they want to have Taysom Hill be flex eligible. No, you don't. Okay, you don't want Taysom Hill to be flex eligible because you don't. You want it. We need to save you from yourself. If you're actually considering doing that, you should not be allowed to do that. So no. Hopefully,
I don't speak for the entirety of football,
but yeah, my opinion. No, come on, give me a break here.
Nice. I took
right,
guys
Matt, on the. Okay,
yeah,
that's
on the clock. I actually took Alan Lazard. Alan Lazard is my 5th wide receiver on my team, as a guy that's the number 2 for Aaron Rodgers, a guy that's being talked up. We talked about him with Dan on the show, just last week. So I don't need to go into it with Lazard. I love him as a 13th round pick. It's a very high upside bench stash. I'm cool with it. So Matt's back on the clock.
Yeah, the running back that I really wanted at my last pick, where I got auto picked Matt Breida, was Damian Harris. Wanted to take him there, and he went like a few picks ahead of me just now. So super pissed about that. Team 7, thanks a lot. You're the best. I'm going to default here to just taking one of my guys at wide receiver, and I'm going to take Curtis Samuel here in the 13th round. Still excited about Samuel, still excited about his opportunity in this offense. And, you know, if there's ever a week where Carolina looks like they're going to be putting up a lot of points, I have Teddy Bridgewater there as well. And also – Now I'm annoyed again because all of like the high upside running backs like Chase Edmonds and Tony Pollard that I were thinking about, they just went there. Probably should have gone that range instead of taking Samuel. So great stuff by your boy Matt Harmon here. But I am going to go ahead and take another like stash running back here. Like I said, really would have liked Edmonds at this pick especially. But I'm going to take A.J. Dillon here. Don't love the Packers' decision to draft A.J. Dillon this year, but they did do it. I think he could factor in sort of as a compliment to Aaron Jones. And then obviously I think if Aaron Jones was to ever get hurt, miss time, whatever, then you're looking at a really good insurance policy there in A.J. Dillon, who I expect to be the number 2 back over Jamal Williams in Green Bay this year.
I'm really all right, wondering Tags, 1408, you went with Paris Campbell here. Let's talk about that super quick while I look at my pick here at the 1412.
Yeah, I like Campbell there. It's no secret that I like him and Reagor in the late rounds. Those are two wide receivers I'm willing to take a chance on. Obviously starting in the slot with Phillip Rivers. He's always loved targets over the middle of the field. For whatever reason, no one really loves Campbell. No one loves Jack Doyle. So it's just gravitating towards T.Y. Hilton. It's like, do we think that he's really the only one that's going to produce here in the passing game? I don't think that's the case. A.J. Dillon is interesting because I think the Packers are in a weird spot where if he comes on the field, I don't think he offers any threat in the passing game. So I think it becomes very predictable, whereas Jamal Williams is a little bit more versatile. I don't know if it was the team gearing up for, you know, being without Aaron Jones and Jamal Williams next year because they're both in their contract years, but Dillon, it's such a hard backfield to predict, and it's almost like I think if Aaron Jones were to go down, I think you'd see a mix of Dillon and Jamal Williams, and I just don't know. I don't get the love fest they have with A.J. Dillon, but again,
it's very weird.
It is. It makes no sense. And they said, Matt LaFleur said he's never seen a human being built like A.J. Dillon. I'm like, you realize Derrick Henry was like on your team, right?
I got Derrick Henry and A.J. Dillon on the same roster right now. So, you know, I'm just, it's the Matt LaFleur special here.
You're going for the most intimidating fantasy football roster. That's what
we might not score a lot of fantasy points, but we're going to look pretty good on the other side of the field there. We're ripped here. Team Harmon is ripped.
That's great.
All right, I went with Michael Pittman Jr. here at the 14-12, and kind of the same arguments that Tags was making with Paris Campbell, looking at Michael Pittman, who I absolutely loved coming out, and I want to get Matt's opinion on Pittman. Obviously, I loved him coming out, and his opportunity in this offense, he's going to be starting day one. They need him. They need this big body presence in this offense. So you'll have Pittman, Hilton, and Paris Campbell out of the slot. So looking at Pittman and his opportunity in this offense, I love him this year. Matt, I also picked Brandon Ayuk there at the 15-01. I just want to gloss over this super quick. Just looking at his opportunity in this offense, they need someone. Now he's dealing with his own potential injury, so that concerns me. But here at the 15-01, I can easily move on from it if need be. So let's double back to Pittman, and then we'll go to Tags' pick. Matt, what did you think about Pittman coming out, and how did he work in reception perception for you?
I liked both of those rookies that you took there. Those are two of my three favorite, like, off, you know, not the first round rookies to take this year from the wide receiver room. Well, Ayuk is a first round pick, but like everybody forgets about him because CeeDee Lamb, Jerry Jeudy. I just forgot about him, for God's sake. So, I would have considered both of those two guys at my pick that I'm on the clock at right now. Love Pittman, though. He was a guy that I think was a top three receiver in this year's draft class. I comp him to Allen Robinson as a guy who, early on in his career, I see him being a downfield threat. I see him being a guy that you use in contested situations. And further on down the line, he can become, I think he has the nuances in his game to be a full field route runner. So I love Pittman, the player. We'll see if he, you know, is on a slow burn because of the nature of this offseason, but I really do like the player a lot.
Yeah, Matt, and I want you to pick. You have 15 seconds. I don't want you to end up with another Matt Reed.
I'm sitting here thinking between two guys, but I'm going to go with another rookie here. I'm going to take Laviska Shenault, who's another rookie that I really, really like from a design touches perspective.
It's fair. That's fair. And by the way, my final pick was Sammy Watkins. I don't know if I've ever gotten him in the last round of a draft, but again, you know, we'll kind of see what happens. Not in love with it, but that's where I wound up with my last pick. And boys, this was the end of the draft.
This was the end.
What are your grades? That's the most important thing. What's everyone's draft grade?
As a guest, we're going to allow you to go ahead and give us your grade first.
I got a B+. I feel pretty good about that. B+, you know, you take that home to mom on your report card. She might not be the most happy, but you're not going to get, you know, these days it's like your iPad privileges or whatever. Spoil damn kids these days. But, you know, back in the day, it probably would have been something else. But yeah. So I feel pretty good about that. I there were definitely spots of the draft where some guys that I wanted got taken, you know, right ahead of me, or was considering between two different positions, didn't get everybody I wanted. But I like the construction of this team because there's two solid quarterbacks. There's the third quarterback in Teddy Bridgewater, who I really like. And because still PPR, so I didn't want to forget the wide receiver position. And I really, really like the mix of upside and security here at the wide receiver room. And the running back spot was always going to be weak, but I think coming away with Derrick Henry, Cam Akers, Ronald Jones, Matt Breida and AJ Dillon, there's a chance there that I at least get two, you know, obviously outside of Derrick Henry, at least maybe one and a half solid starters out of these guys.
There you go.
Well, that's the thing about Superflex that makes it a ton more fun, is that there is never going to be this position that's super strong on your roster, right? Like, there's always going to be one position that you just can't focus on, right? Because you have to take these quarterbacks. So you're rolling the dice, right? Like with me, it's wide receivers. I got an 86 out of 100. And that's looking at this wide receiver room of Tyreek Hill, Calvin Ridley, Jamison Crowder. And then I had to throw some darts later on, right? I had Mecole Hardman, Brandon Ayuk, DeSean Jackson, Michael Pittman Jr. So I think it's not as strong of a unit as it would be in a typical one quarterback league. But Tags, how did you do?
I have a new friend with me in the room. It's called a giant trophy. I got a 94 out of 100.
Wow.
Give me a break.
I'm the best. If you ain't first, you're last. And I'd just like to thank Yates and Harmon for making this possible. No, but my roster, I like the way it turned out. I'll run through it real quick just so you guys know what it is. Matthew Stafford and Gardner Minshew is my starting quarterbacks, which, again, I know it's not sexy, but I think it's competent. My running backs, Alvin Kamara and Joe Mixon, David Johnson in the flex. Wide receivers, Amari Cooper, A.J. Green, Deontay Johnson as the starters. Travis Kelce is my starting tight end. And every now and then, I have to be reminded when you have Travis Kelce, it's like another wide receiver one, where I push Travis Kelce into my wide receiver one slot, slide Deontay Johnson as my tight end, and I'm really, really happy about that. And then my bench is just littered with guys that have upside. Jalen Reagor, Alan Lazard, Sammy Watkins, Paris Campbell, and then Dwayne Haskins is my third quarterback. So I dig my roster, guys. I didn't think that I was going to get a 94 out of 100, but again, thank you guys for making this possible.
You're the top ranked team according to the little draft analyzer, but you know who's got the best bench? Highest scoring bench right here. I didn't know you get great. Yeah, you guys are advanced here at Fantasy Pros. You do it overall starters and then the bench. I like that. I like to have the best bench in the league. Pretty cool stuff.
There you go.
All right, guys, that is all the time we have for today. Huge thank you to Matt Harmon for joining us today. It was a lot of fun, man.
Yeah, appreciate it. Thanks so much. It's fun to be doing the drafts right now because it's like we're not getting the same influx, I think, of news that we normally would this time of year, but we're still getting sort of small nuggets coming in, and it's interesting, like, how much do you just want to stick with your convictions, the things that you've held all offseason or, you know, a portion of the offseason here once football started to kind of ramp back up versus what do you want to change in August? It's, again, set it up top, continue to say it. It's the weirdest season ever, but a lot of fun kind of running through it with you guys today.
Absolutely.
Thanks for coming on, man. All right, and don't forget to follow him on Twitter if you don't already, at @MattHarmon_BYB. Also, don't forget that we have this enormous giveaway going on right now, guys, that we'll be handing out as soon as we hit 7,000 reviews on Apple Podcasts. Just go to fantasypros.com/contest to enter. For Mike Tagliere and Matt Harmon, I'm Kyle Yates, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks for tuning into the Fantasy Pros YouTube channel. Make sure to check out our featured videos as well. Also, make sure to click that red subscribe button to get notified when we post videos in the future.